All right, we're back with another alt-right show with Center-Right Federation, and America is being a shite, so we didn't show up.
Unfortunately, but we're trying to get people in here right now, so we'll see if anyone's interested in joining. And okay, we're also leaving the link, but you can't be a cuck.
Yeah, just to say, like, in the little chat that's on the current live stream, if you want to join. Then we'll...
this is what you should do to prevent the cucks from coming in. If you don't want the cucks coming in, what you should do is see if they leave it on the chat, go on their YouTube profiles, and leave it to them privately somewhere.
Oh, yeah, they're not degenerates. We're trying to know two people who are degenerates, so they can't come in here. Sorry, it's new rules, mate.
All right, so what do you want to talk about?
We can talk about the cucks, degenerates. How communists are the contradictions of communism in the left.
All right.
Or the 8 glaring contradictions of the left, because you did do a good video, but the quality was terrible.
Yeah, because my mic was lagging like crazy.
Yeah, so I said I was going to do a new one, and I still have a rant to upload. So, do you want to go pull up the thing, the 8 glaring contradictions of the left, or you want me to? I can go find it.
I can get it up.
Oh yeah, let me just go give me like the link to it and I'll read it off, because this is important that it's
the blood of the white devils.
Oh thanks.
All right, America's available right now.
Send him in. Get him in. Get his freaking ass in here. 8 glaring contradictions on the left. All right, so I know this is by, Rocky Mystery. Credit goes to him, of course, because I'm not going to plagiarize and just read it. That's wrong.
Yeah.
So it says, morality is subjective, except when we say so. The left believes that morality is a series of subjective assertions that have no basis in absolute truth or objectivity. That is, of course, very true. Like we know. Morals are subjective. Sure, mate.
Yeah, mate.
And now it's gone. An especially pricky subject for the left is natural law. Particularly natural rights, this is in parentheses, and don't you dare talk about personal responsibility. Rational, intellectual, brush away all moral absolutes dismissively whenever it conflicts with their beliefs. But wait! A moral statement, or any statement at all, without ending with an absolute conclusion. Oh, that's just... culturally biased thinking, and that has no place in modern society. Left will cry.
What, yeah, what more. Would you add if you had to like edit this article, what else would you add? Instead of making it an 8, what making it like, let's say, a 9, what would you add on it?
Oh, I'd add how communist. It's authoritarianism. Authoritarianism is wrong unless we do it.
Oh yeah, that's true.
They'll say how fascist, like black shits could go up and bash some Italian communists in the head and murder a bunch of them. Oh, that's wrong, Goy. You can't do that. But they'll kill, like, die, you stupid fascists. You racists. No, I don't think so. How dare you? No, no, that's all. How dare you stand against the proletariat?
How dare you, Goy?
Oh, there's Tom.
Hey, Tom.
Hey, guys. What's going on?
We're doing a thing on the contradictions of the left. And much more.
Do we really need to expose them? I mean, aren't they self-evident?
Yeah, gender is a social construct, except when you have the brain of the wrong sex.
Radical feminists proclaim to the world that gender is a social construct. This is a very subtle sleight of hand. However, because gender doesn't actually exist, still leftists will try to argue that your brain cannot be defined by your sex, and that all differences related to sex are limited purely to external anatomy. Of course, people that can think for themselves know this is nonsense, with so many obvious everyday differences between the sexes, not least career choices related to brain sex. Men tend to dominate STEM subjects, while women tend to prefer subjects based on liberal arts and humanities, or any other area involving care, from teaching and social work to medicine. Setting this aside, the left regularly get itself into a muddle when it tries to marry this queer theory the idea that gender is a fluid concept that exists on a spectrum that doesn't sound too contradictory, you might say, ah, but you see, you can't have a transsexual identity and still assert that that brain sex doesn't exist. Yeah, that's actually true.
I have the body, I have the brain of the opposite sex. Sure you do. Sure you do. It's just mounds of nonsense, dude. They say how, like, well, we're not going to mention any names, but he's saying the only solution to gender dysphoria is basically caving into their mental illness. Like, really?
It's like telling a person with schizophrenia that the voices in their head are real.
Yeah, exactly. It's exactly what it is. It's nonsense, dude. It's garbage.
Hey, Tom, can you give your example again? I thought it was funny.
Which one? I'm sorry, guys. I'm eating dinner right now, so I might be a bit quiet.
All right.
That's fine.
So what example are you talking about?
Remember the one where you said that the heroin addict goes in there with insects inside his skin or something like that?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, lots of like crackheads think that bugs are crawling beneath their flesh. And there are actually incidents of crackheads like taking razors to their skin to try to get them out. And it, like, a doctor giving somebody sex reassignment surgery and mutilating their genitals is pretty much the same thing as giving a razor blade to a crackhead and just be like, hey, go crazy, man.
Well, it is. It's nonsense. And I'm going to get the cucks in the comments like, yeah, you're not letting dissent in. This is an echo chamber.
But you know what, guys? Sanity is a social construct, too. So, you know what? It's wrong for us to judge crackheads who think that there are bugs in their skin. The reason that they hurt themselves, guys, is because they're being discriminated against. So we just need to be nicer to them.
It's all conditioned.
Yeah.
Yeah, we should cut their skin off if they have imaginary bugs in there.
Yeah. And then we all have to just turn the other way when they look all gross and defleshed. Just pretend there's nothing wrong with them.
This is the best contradiction yet. Race doesn't exist, except when you're white.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oi, you racist goy.
Well, that's actually a funny thing, because, like, white people are really the only race who have this mentality that, you know, race doesn't exist, and we can all, you know, we're all just one human race, and, you know, there's no distinctions between anybody, but yet nobody else thinks that. Like, if you get a black guy, he's going to be like, yeah, you know what, I'm black, and you know what, I like being black, and I like hanging out with other black people. Whereas, you know, an Indian guy is going to be like, you know what, I'm Indian, I'm proud to be Indian, I like to hang out with other Indians. But with a white person, it's just like, no, whiteness doesn't exist, it's a social construct, blah, blah, blah.
La, 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 race doesn't exist, la, 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 la.
Except if there's whiteness.
Well, I mean, it doesn't...
according to the left.
Well, I mean, like, I think that there's a valid scientific debate to be had about whether race actually exists or not. But that's not really the point, because different cultures, they see themselves as being ethnically distinct. And regardless of whether or not there actually is a scientific thing as race, people actually, like, there is a notion of race that exists, just like there is a notion of religion that exists. You know, people believe themselves to be Catholic or Jewish or whatever. So to say that race doesn't exist scientifically, it doesn't mean that it doesn't exist as a notion among people. And for white people to just say, like, you know what, we're just going to treat everybody equally, like, we're not going to acknowledge other people's whiteness or blackness or whatever, we're just going to be colorblind, like, that's a big thing among white people. And I was watching a Stefan Molyneux video, and he gave the example of, like, imagine there's a soccer game, and one of the teams on the soccer game, they only pass the ball to themselves, whereas the other team, they pass the ball to everybody. Now, which team is going to win? Is it going to be the team that passes to everybody or the team that passes to themselves?
The team that passes it to themselves?
Yeah, so you can say, like, oh, you know what, the rules of the soccer game are a social construct. There's no such thing as soccer scientifically. I mean, all that's bullshit. It's just fucking mental masturbation.
Losing a game is a social construct.
Yeah, but the fact of the matter is that other people, like, blacks see themselves as ethnically distinct.
Yeah.
Like, Asians see themselves as ethnically distinct. I mean, I know a lot of Koreans and Chinese, and trust me, they're very, very conscious of race. They, like, Chinese people, like, by the standards of the left and, you know, cultural Marxists, Chinese people are some of the most racist people ever. I mean, I don't care. I mean, I love Chinese people, but, like, they like, race is the first thing that they notice among people. Like, I'll be with some of my Chinese friends, and they'll be saying, like, oh, you see that fucking nigger? And they'll just be like, damn, like, a white guy could never get away with saying something like that. So, like, other people, they see race, and it would just be really stupid. It almost suicidal to just say, like, oh, we should just be colorblind.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's true, because these Chinese people, they even say Korean, they, zigzig, there's your Korean.
Yeah, even amongst, like,
other Asians.
Like, Chinese people will like, distinguish between Japanese and Koreans, and, like, there's a lot of, like, inter-East Asian racism going around. Like, try to get a Korean and a Chinese guy in a room with each other. Like, there'll be a lot of tension.
Damn.
More with the Japanese and the Korean, though.
Yeah, like a lot of those groups just don't like each other. It's weird.
But yeah, white people are racist.
Yeah. You're only racist if you're white. Because you know what? Like, power. Racism equals power plus privilege, guys.
Oh, yeah. Like, the AIDS skooks. You're a white male!
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Wasn't it that social justice warrior who said that to that white Trump supporter?
Yeah, that's like, it's called AIDS skrillex.
You're a fucking white male. Oh yeah, and they also made a Facebook page of this friend, and it's called Carl the Cuck.
Yeah, that's in the same video.
Yeah,
are you kidding me?
They did. I think it was like Carl the Cuck, and it was like AIDS skrillex and like Carl or something like that. It looked like Beavis and Butthead.
You're a fucking white male. What does that have to do with anything?
I don't know. Or a triggery path.
Yeah, it's hilarious that the Trump campaign has just made all these leftists trigger themselves so hard. It's hilarious. And you know what? You know what this is doing? It's making people go to the right. Like, the average person sees this shit, like AIDS Skrillex and Carl the Cuck, and they're like, I don't want to be a part of that. Like, screw, I don't want to be some shrill, humorless piece of crap. Like, fuck it, I'll vote Trump. I think it's making people vote for Trump.
Yeah, that's the thing, though. That's what I'm liking, is that all these riots and stuff done by these leftists is only making Trump more popular in the polls.
Exactly.
Or if it was 10 years ago, they'd all be running to, like, fedora tipping, like, Edge. Fedora, I'd be like, oh, crap. Like, oh, never mind.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's... From observing the political atmosphere in the past 16 years or so, I've come to believe that the political atmosphere, or the zeitgeist, if you will, it really comes in cycles. Like, when George Bush was in office, the trendy, edgy thing, trendy, edgy mentality was to be super left-wing, to be, like, anti-war, anti-capitalism, like, down with the system, man, screw Bush. I remember there was this...
Fuck America.
Screw religion.
American flag on fire.
Yeah,
screw
religion. Like, there was this trend called Rock Against Bush, where, like, all these major rock bands would write songs about how much they hated George Bush. And now, like, now that Obama's in office, because cultural Marxism and, left-wing mentality has become so prevalent, the countercultural movement has shifted to the right. And, like, the mainstream is left-wing, and so the counterculture has become right-wing. And that's exactly what we're seeing right now. And I believe, like, I'm not saying that this is what I want, but I think that if Trump gets elected, which, I mean, at this point it kind of looks like he will, I think that the Overton window is probably going to move to the left again, because, like, the countercultural movement will become left-wing, and, yeah, we're going to basically see a resurgence of this anti-American, anti-nationalist position, like we saw in the Bush years.
True.
I mean, I'm not saying that that's what I want, but I just think that that's naturally how things progress.
I've seen lefties, like, when, since, like, a lot of, since 2005, like, all, like, the left gained some, a lot of grounds. I had, like, the left wings the future, and, like, it shifts around, mate. Mm-hmm. Your ideas are not going to continue to progress, and then everyone's going to be a bunch of cucks one day.
Yeah.
Yeah, because you can only, take, like, the cultural Marxist sentiment so far. Like, beyond a certain point, it just becomes ridiculous. And now that they've achieved gay rights, and they've accepted, like, feminism and all this other shit, there really is no next step that's going to be widely accepted. Like, what can they achieve next? Like, acceptance of pedophilia,
incest,
of transsexuals.
Like, incest.
Like, I'm pretty sure a lot of people are, like, a lot of, like, people who've been indoctrinated by Marxist professors in college will eat that up, but the average person's not going to accept pedophiles.
No.
But that's just, no matter how much conditioning and brainwashing you stuff down people's throats, pedophiles are never going to be accepted, transsexuals are not going to be accepted, and that's what we're seeing now, is this huge jump to the right. Because you can't force this shit down people's throats.
Yeah, that's true.
The cooks.
Hey, Tom, do you think Trump's wall will be approved by Congress?
I still don't know about that. I think that not only is Trump's wall going to be is going to cause a lot of social upheaval, but it's going to be logistically very difficult to build because there are a ton of mountains across the U.S.-Mexican border. And unless you have hundreds of billions of dollars and the best engineers in the world, I don't see a wall covering the entirety of the U.S.-Mexican border. And the border is huge, let's be honest here.
Yeah, it is huge.
Like, I don't know. It remains to be seen. Maybe he'll build it. Maybe he won't. I think if he doesn't build it, he's not going to stand re-election because, excuse me, most of the people who are voting for Trump, that's really their main issue. They want to see that wall built. And, you know, I kind of want to see a wall built too, but I don't know. I don't know if it's going to happen.
Here's the main obstacle, though. It's the Rio Grande River.
Yeah, there's that too. And then you have the fucking Pacific Ocean, because you have to build it across the Baja Peninsula, presumably. So, I don't know. It's just going to be logistically very difficult to build.
Yeah, that's true.
And, like, despite the huge trade deficit that the U.S. has with Mexico, I think that Trump really has his work cut out for him, convincing the Mexican government to pay and build this wall. Like, I don't know, he's going to have to employ some serious negotiating skills if that's what he wants. But hey,
the Mexican president was saying that he wanted to build the wall.
Was this Vicente Fox or the new guy?
It's, hold on, what's the new guy's name again?
I can't recall off the top of my head, but Vicente Fox was the prime minister, the president of Mexico for a long time, and he was recently succeeded by somebody else.
Well, I don't know who it was Vicente Fox. It was him.
Mm. Yeah, because he recently apologized to Trump.
Yeah.
For the longest time, he basically said, like, fuck you, Trump. You're not getting into office. You can kiss my ass. And then when, like, right when Trump won the nomination, like, as soon as Cruz dropped out, Vicente Fox was issuing an apology to Trump and being like, you know, we're going to extend an olive branch to you. I hope we can work things out. And then Trump basically said, yeah, you better have those dollars saved up for that wall you're going to build.
I feel like if I was president, I'd be more hated than Trump.
Of course, Ethan. You're alt-right.
I think we all would.
Well, especially me.
Well, definitely Delta. Everybody will like literally be setting cities on fire just to stop Delta from talking.
Well, you know what, Delta? If it's like what I was talking about earlier. I think that if Hillary gets into office, we're going to see a huge shift to the right. Like, I'm sure that if Hillary is elected in office, by the time 2020 rolls around, people are going to be openly embracing National Socialism and fascism, and like, I wouldn't rule out a Delta USA presidency if that was the case.
You'd rather have this guy.
Would you consider yourself a libertarian nationalist?
Wait, Delta?
No, Tom. You.
Yeah, actually. I mean, I've been reading some Hans Hermann Hoppe lately, and
all right. So me and Tom are the extremists among libertarians.
Well, I mean, extreme in what sense? I mean, I'm sure you could say that, you know, the libertarian socialists, if that's really a thing, they're pretty extreme in my books.
Well, yeah, but they're cucked, though. That's the thing. It doesn't count. They're cucked.
Yeah. Yeah. I wouldn't say that they're cucked, really. Cucking is when you claim to be a part of something. Like, for example, cuck applies really well to conservatives who are very centrist, because despite the fact that they claim to be conservatives, like who is a good example, like, I don't know, like Jeb Bush or Rick Wilson or any of these little fucking slime balls who say, like, oh, we're conservatives, we believe in free markets and all this stuff. And yet, if they were ever to be elected into office, they would be for, like, complete corporatism, complete government regulations, bailing out the banks, open borders. They really don't care about the values that they espouse. They're in it to make a buck. They're just they're motivated by whoever gives them the most money, essentially. And, you know, we all know who that is.
Yeah.
We all know who that is, Goy. Don't forget to tune into Bella and the Bulldogs, Goyum.
Soros. Of course.
Alright, so what else? So somebody whose name shall not be mentioned, we've all had an exchange with him, and we all know he's obsessed with us, but however, he once claimed that the right was promoting pedophilia. But yet, even though we've seen the majority of the time, it's the left. So, can anyone give an example? I could give one when the left have tried it. Salon.com.
Oh, yeah, there's that infamous article.
Oh, or back in the 70s, they tried it, but never got any traction.
Well, you know about the group NAMBLA, right?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Well, most of the key figures of NAMBLA, like Allen Ginsberg, they're all a bunch of commies.
Oh, yeah, they were Marxists.
Yeah.
Yeah, so what does that tell you?
Exactly. It tells you that the people who are behind this this normalization of pedophilia is the left.
It's not the right-wing bigot conspiracy theory or anything.
Oh, yeah, and also cuckoldry. They also try to blame it on the right.
How so?
Like, what I once had, like, a leftist saying that the reason why we throw around the word conservative or cuckold is because we're just projecting ourselves onto everyone, because in reality we're all the cucks and we're the ones that are actually behind it. But the thing is, though, if you look at who's also promoting cuckoldry, you would see that it's the radical feminists who are left wing, who usually say that that they say that. Men who don't allow their wives to fuck other, like, men is misogynist. So you could see that it's the left that are basically promoting this.
What's going on?
I don't know. I'm getting a call from... Oh, Luis.
Oh, God. tell him you'll be there in a minute.
I think he wants to join this live stream.
I'll let him in.
Let's see what he does. But there's another who cannot be named.
Somebody else to talk. I'm eating right now.
Yeah. And America, I think, is a fug right now, Ethan.
Yeah. Who else? Where else have you guys seen cuckoldry being promoted by the left?
Just degenerates in general.
Well, yeah. I mean, I saw some propaganda released by the German government recently that promoted how like German women should have sex with migrants. They released a bunch of posters advocating for safe sex, and all the couples on the posters consisted of a white woman and a brown guy. So if that's not subliminal advertising, I don't know what it is.
Yeah, that's true. The left are promoting this cuckoldry stuff.
And it's not just them. Have you ever heard of the group called Femin?
Oh, God. Dude, they're so degenerate. They can get thrown out of helicopters for all
of them. Isn't it funded by George Soros?
Yeah, they are. But they released a statement recently because National Front, the French Nationalist Party, they basically said, you know what, guys? You need to start having more children, because if you don't have more children, French people are going to die out, and that's absolutely true. But then Femin came along, and they're like, this is racist, this is sexist. What you gals should be doing instead is having sex with those migrants. I want to see a colored bun in every oven, because we need to enrich France with the diversity.
Oh, which God.
It's most, absolutely disgusting.
Hey, Delta, would you support a homogenous Europe?
Duh.
Yeah, I don't think melting pots and stuff work in Europe, because Europe already has a national identity.
I don't think the melting pots really work anywhere.
Except America,
France, the U.S.
Hmm?
It could work fine here in the U.S., because since we were built up by different cultures everywhere, that's the reason why the melting pot works here. But then when we look at Europe, because Europe already has a national identity, they seem to, it doesn't seem to work.
Okay, well, a melting pot would work in theory if everybody assimilated to the culture. Like, if everybody who came to America, Muslims and Africans, Asians...
Ow!
Man, that hurt my ears. Okay, let's say... If you had a society where everybody, all these immigrants assimilated into American culture, then that would be fine. But they don't. They form these insular little groups, and they stick to themselves. And that's why you have, these no-go zones in Europe, where you're not allowed to walk down the street without being killed. That's why you have these giant ghettoized areas in the United States that consist of, all Dearborn, Michigan, that are all just, Somalis. And if you go down the street, you'll be attacked.
I melting pots could work except for Islam, because there's even no-go zones in the United States where Muslims, if you look at Islamburg, it's like a little commune, in Muslim commune in New York, and everyone there's American, they're black, they're African Americans. That are Muslim. So, you struggle to get, no-go zones in religion.
That's the thing I was suggesting the other day. We should just, ban all Muslim immigration, because the thing about Muslims is that they don't integrate to societies. All they do
is... Hey, son, fix your mic.
All they do is try to force their religion down people's throats.
Well, those Muslims born here and they don't seem to do that.
No, they do. You heard of Islamburg?
Islamburg, where's that?
That's in, New York.
Oh, shit.
Well, I mean, the San Bernardino shooters, they were born in the United States. I think they were third-generation immigrants.
We should also talk about Takiya.
Oh, that. Someone's mic's echoing. Who is it?
I think it's coming from America's muted.
I think the ADL is listening in.
Yeah, I want to point out that the same thing.
It's Tom, because he doesn't. I don't hear him echoing.
The melting pot could affect Latinos, because there were always Hispanics in North America, even during 1776. There were actually Cubans, because they were traders. They trade with the colonies, and at one point, Cuba, for a short period of time, was a part of Great Britain. and also most of Spanish territory. Same thing with Puerto Rico. There were many, even during the 1860s, there were many Cuban and Puerto Rican Americans like Jose Marti and Lebres. They're all from New York, and they fought for like Cuban and Puerto Rican independence. They're all immigrated to the United States and to able to free Cuba and a sort of attempt with Puerto Rico and the Grito de Lares.
But I think we should be careful about comparing immigrants from like Latin and Central America to like immigrants from, I don't know, like Pakistan or from like South Africa or Zimbabwe, because the immigrants who come from, let's say, like Cuba, Puerto Rico, or Dominican Republic, like they're much closer to being culturally American than people from Zimbabwe or people from Liberia. So I think it's kind of unfair to say like, oh, because these immigrants, they assimilate well, then we should just welcome all immigrants, because you know they're probably all like that.
Nah,
not Islam.
Yeah, especially not Islam.
I know there's gonna be some Muslims that are triggered.
Chango's a second generation immigrant. His father was from South Africa.
Shit! Don't bring any names up, nigga.
Oh, Tom, remember when we're discussing the white genocide in South Africa?
Mm-hmm.
And remember how you said that many black people in South Africa are desperate to bring the apartheid back?
Oh yeah.
Damn.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's your thoughts? What's your thoughts on apartheid?
Well, I mean, the funny thing is there seems to be there's like the respect between whites and blacks is not mutual. You have to understand that. Whites in South Africa or in general might respect black people and they might say, oh, you're welcome into our communities. But the fact is that the reverse is not true. Black people, especially in South Africa and many of these places, they don't respect white people. They see white people as settlers and imperialists, and they blame them wrongfully for a lot of the misfortunes that they're enduring. I mean, it was the black people who chanted one settler, one bullet during the protests against apartheid. And you look at people like, what was her name, Amy Beale, who was an American anti-apartheid activist who traveled to South Africa in the early 90s, and she was like protesting against apartheid. She was saying like, you know, like, oh, we love black people, we should take them into our communities. But she was beaten to death, her head was smashed in with a brick, and she was raped, and then once apartheid was ended, her killers were released from prison as an act of reconciliation. So what does that tell you about how much the blacks of South Africa respect white people there?
Not at all.
Yeah, so, I mean, why do the blacks want to be within white communities? Is it because the white communities are prosperous and they have a lot of money, or is it because they really like white people and they want to hang out with them?
Uh-huh. We spent their money, man. Shit.
Yeah, like, to be honest, apartheid would probably be better than what they have right now.
Yeah, I mean, you look at these cities like Johannesburg that have been turned into basically giant designated shitting streets because...
Okay, I'm back.
Yeah, a lot of these people don't know how to live in an urban setting and don't know how to use running toilets, and they just turn these places into complete shitholes. I mean, there's garbage littered across the streets.
Didn't you see that there was a bunch of jungle dindus coming into the city and killing a bunch of people?
Yeah, that's exactly what you have. Because, like, these people, they're not accustomed to living in a city or, you know, in a house. They've been living in, you know, jungle huts their whole lives. And when you release these people into the cities and the urban centers, they just go crazy. Like, they take over office buildings. I think I mentioned this before, like, they'll take out an entire window and just, like, shit out the whole of the building. And then it's a disaster.
Yeah, modern South Africa is full of...
disgusting degenerates.
Yeah, aren't, like, white people also being killed on mass amounts as well?
Yeah.
Like, they're being sent to slaughterhouses.
Well, I don't know about that, but yeah, like, there's a lot of street violence, and there are certainly many neighborhoods.
The slaughterhouse thing, actually, like, there are, like, gangs that are, like kidnapping, like, Afrikaners and sending them to slaughterhouses.
Well, I mean, that wouldn't surprise me, but yeah, white people are not treated very well in most of the majority black neighborhoods.
Nelson, people think he's, you know, he was responsible for many torture and bombings.
I don't like him.
I would have to agree with, like, a British guy ran into a while back. I have to say he was a terrorist. At the time, I got really mad, but now I'd have to agree with him.
Yeah, I heard he once bombed the church as well.
Don't fix their mics, man. Holy crap.
Nelson Mandela, his wife especially was a terrorist.
Didn't his wife like to kill people by putting a wheel over them and then setting them on fire?
Nelson Mandela's wife liked to put wheels, like, they call it, I forgot what they call it, but
it's called the neck.
Fire searing, and, like, what they would do, they would put tires around people's heads, and they would, like, light them with gasoline and burn them to death.
Yeah. Whoa. Well, sort of.
That's what they do to white people in South Africa, and I think they even do the same in Zimbabwe.
They did to Zulus, too. Because the Zulus
were what?
Yeah, they did to black Zulus because they weren't communists.
Yeah, Zulus.
That's the truth. I want to talk right now. Yeah, they will take a tire and put it around their neck, and what they do is they catch it on fire, and the tire will melt. You got all the melted tar all over the face, and you just burn, and you die from suffocation.
So Delta, you being half black, half
white.
Luis!
There's also a right-wing party that fought against apartheid.
Ethan was speaking.
You being half black, half white, would you support the apartheid in South Africa?
Probably. It's better off. If black people are getting all these privileges and whites being treated like utter garbage, why would I want to have it where... I don't want to see anyone in that case getting screwed over.
Yeah.
But boy, they racist.
To me, it's a huge act of hypocrisy that... people in, I believe it's Oxford University, they want to tear down a giant statue of Cecil Rhodes, who actually did a lot of good, not only for the people of Britain, but also of Africa as well. I mean, he built a huge telegraph line that connected the north and the south of Africa. He opened diamond mines. He started administration. And yet, what did Nelson Mandela do? He was part of a terrorist wing called MK, which they bombed train stations, they bombed shopping malls, they killed countless thousands of people. Like, the guy was basically on the level of Osama bin Laden. Yet everybody loves Nelson Mandela, but yet Cecil Rhodes is seen as some sort of movie.
You know what's ironic, Vlad, is they hate Gaddafi, but they love Nelson Mandela, even though Nelson Mandela got money from Gaddafi to do a lot of the terrorist attacks.
Yeah.
It's ironic. But that's, you know, Gaddafi, I think, went against the global banks. That's why they got rid of him. Nelson Mandela.
I like Gaddafi, Assad, and Saddam.
It's funny because Gaddafi actually predicted the migrant crisis. He said, if you guys get rid of me, like, you're basically opening the floodgates to a ton of migrants coming into Europe. And look what happened, like, 4 years after his death. Lo and behold.
I think that's why they got rid of him, and they're trying to get rid of him.
Like, the people in the Middle East, especially, they need a dictator that could kill them. Because democracy does not work over there.
I'd say long live the Arab Bath. No democracy in the Middle East.
You have your cast up the party?
Wait, what?
Everyone's echoing.
Cast up the party.
Whoever's echoing, mute their mic for right now so we don't get this echo effect, unless you want to talk.
I want to talk. Inkatha Freedom Party. It's a party in South Africa. They were anti-communist and they fought against apartheid. They even said that, they even quoted that Nelson Mandela did nothing to end apartheid. We did. And what they did, mass protests. They fight troops, militants. And they were basically Zulus. So,
Anyone have any thoughts on that? That's pretty interesting.
They were very right-wing and anti-communist.
I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, there were a ton of conservative parties that were actually opposed to both the apartheid and the communists in South Africa.
And they took it in the butt for it.
Well, you know, I think apartheid was like a neo-Nazi thing, right?
Well, I wouldn't say neo-Nazi, but rather it was like more of a white nationalist thing.
No, the reason why they created apartheid is because I watched this video. They wanted to protect European culture. They wanted to protect African cultures. Like at the beginning stage, it was just meant to protect cultures, but later it went
exactly. It's kind of like what me and Alfred were just talking about earlier. It's where every race has every right to exist.
Were you talking to him like on Hangouts?
No, I was just talking to him in the chat right now, and
The former president of the Institute of Apartheid said that I'm not a racist. I care about people. We need to respect people's culture. They teach both white and black. So
wait. Do any of you guys know about Robert Duterte in the Philippines?
Someone get Alfred in here if he's around.
Alfred is in.
Alfred's I don't even know how to pronounce it. I'll be right back.
Get your fucking ass in here.
Alfred is making a bunch of comments in your video.
I think it's like midnight where he is.
That's true. Shit.
Hey, Alfred, is Merkel running around over there?
That's it.
Alfred's commenting on your video right now on the live stream. Look at
all right. We'll put Alfred aside right now. I think Pinochet wanted to say something.
Oh, some guys call me Ethiopian Mussolini.
I'm back. Oh, hey, Ethiopian Mussolini. So any of you guys ever heard of Robert Duterte or Duterte? I don't know how to pronounce his name. Some kind of Filipino. But he's running for office, right? For president of the Philippines.
Wait. Is he the guy who makes a rape joke or
I don't know. Maybe he does. I know he's well known for being a communist and a vigilante that murdered people in brutal ways, for minor offenses sometimes.
Wow, that's messed up.
But so he's amazingly powerful. So they use social media as his battle platform. They cover up his tracks, but. He's basically from a Filipino friend I have. He said he was controlled by the communist leaders. Some guy named Jose Maria Sison, the Muro Islamic Liberation Front, a pastor named Apollo Quibuli, Iglesia Ni Cristo. I imagine that's a Catholic priest, and they have a whole voting block scheme. So the former president Gloria Araujo and her former military generals. The New People's Army, the Communist Party, and China, and all these strong political groups in the Philippines, all connected to the left, are trying to get this guy in power, basically.
Oh, he has a lot of support. They should have a Ferdinand Marcos regime, because wasn't Ferdinand Marcos was he the Pinochet of the Philippines?
Yes.
We should bring him back.
I got a better idea.
Suharto was the Pinochet version of Indonesia.
I got a better idea, though, for that for the Philippines problem. Why don't we just make it the Commonwealth of the Philippines again?
Oh, yeah.
Bring it back into America. There you go.
I like that.
Yeah, they just had a referendum to become a U.S. territory again. The Philippines is one of the nations. It's the number one nation that looked like America since they were once a part of America as a colony. Even a friend of mine, Danny, he invited me to a group in Facebook called Filipino Statehood, and they want Philippines to be a U.S. state.
Why isn't Puerto Rico a U.S. state yet?
Because America's weird.
Because it takes time. And according to the contract, they said that if they decide to make Puerto Rico a state, it will take place in the year 2020. It takes time to
Do people in Puerto Rico want to become a state?
60%, according to the referendum, 60% want statehood, 50% want to stay the same, and only 5% wants independence.
So, like, what is the argument of the people who want to remain independent? Do they just not like the United States?
Well, it's a comma. I talked about the ones who want full independence to stay the comma.
Like the people who want to be to not be a state.
So Commonwealth, because there's two people. Commonwealth would be the same, or independence, what you're trying to talk about.
Well, I mean, I guess the independent advocate.
All right, independents are very nationalist and patriotic on their own island. They're pretty much very left wing, but they're very politically right-wing. They're very conservative, but very left-wing. Like, they want to protect Christian values, they want to ban abortion, they want to ban gay marriage, or they want an economic system like Denmark and Sweden. I'm not kidding. Even on the I'm doing a video right now, I'm writing a script right now to a video on this a woman who's running for governor as an independent. She said that she wants to have a economic and political system in Puerto Rico that is based on Iceland.
Interesting.
Back, my fellow Americans. Hallelujah.
Hey, Tom, do you know anything about Iceland?
Hey, Delta, send Alfred the link.
I did.
I mean,
put it in the chat. And Hangouts. Okay, Alfred. Do I even have a PM with Alfred?
Alfred,
if you're watching, go to the Nationalist Hangout, because I added you there.
Well, Iceland used to have a lot of economic freedom prior to the 2007 financial crisis, right?
I guess so. I think it was 2008 financial crisis.
Well, yeah, the political leaders, especially I think the leader of the National Bank of Iceland, he was very libertarian-minded, and he wanted to have, like, he wanted to abolish economic regulations, and a lot of left-wingers like Krugman, they blame him, particularly for the financial crash that affected Iceland.
Ooh.
Wait, that explains the revolution they had in Iceland?
I don't know about the revolution, but yeah. I know they used to be very libertarian-minded.
I love this leftist
contradiction. The floor of the bank.
We believe in free speech, except when you disagree with us.
When was the revolution in Iceland?
Yeah, they flag people and report you if you disagree with them.
Yeah. Or economics work.
No, wait, can we have it in Iceland now? They can, like, you can get arrested for disagreeing with somebody now?
I don't think in Iceland. I was bringing up a leftist contradiction.
Oh, okay. I just came back, so I just misheard.
Oh.
Because I know Iceland's pretty screwed up, right?
I think so, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay, it happened in 2008.
Do any of you guys ever listen to Michael Savage?
Yeah, I've listened to him.
I like Michael Savage. I have his book, Government Zero. And yeah. I think he actually has the best way on, like, how you stop, like, all the, you know, the, you know, all the, this mass immigration. You have to ban immigration for 7 years. I like that idea. And also what you have to do is you need an immigration policy that brings in only productive individuals, not, like, you know, just people who are going to live off the welfare system, actually people who can serve the country.
Another way, also Tom's method, get rid of the welfare state, like, in Europe, because you know how a lot of the refugees, the rapefugees, are in there for the gives me that?
Yeah.
Gives me that. Give me that 350.
So a lot of them are just in there for the welfare and stuff, so the best thing to do is get rid of the welfare state, so all the rapefugees can start running out.
Well, I mean, you don't even necessarily have to get rid of the welfare state.
I see the unstumpable one.
You just reserve the benefits and the gives for the native-born Europeans, and not for first-generation immigrants.
Oh yeah, true.
That was Alfred.
Hey, give me that 350. Anyone gotta say anything about gives me that?
I was hoping we could also talk about Rhodesia, since earlier we were talking about apartheid.
I love Rhodesia.
Oh, Rhodesia. I gotta get that flag.
Right, Rhodesia did not have any racial segregation.
Well, I mean, in part of, like, early Rhodesian history, they did have some segregation, but over time, in order to appease a lot of the Western states, they introduced more and more egalitarian reforms. And by the end of Rhodesia, they actually had a black president in office, and they had, like, preferential treatment for blacks. But that still wasn't good enough to appease the international elite there, Goy. So they got taken over by the black commies in ZANU.
Oh, Mugabe, who just, like, he took all the land away from white people, which again, they did the same thing in Chile.
Because the commies we argue with like to say that that basically apartheid and Rhodesia were the same thing, even though Rhodesia did not have, like, the same exact laws that apartheid had.
Well, yeah. They had, like, a black person working a job in Rhodesia would commonly earn the same wage that a white guy had.
Also, Tom, they had black people in their military who were, like, some of the most loyal fighters.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, we're not going to hear that from the... We're not going to hear that from the elite, Goy.
No. Yeah, plus, now that Robert Mugabe the monkey threw out all the white farmers off their land, now that there's a shit ton of famine, even Robert Mugabe around 2015, I think, begged for all the whites to come back.
Yeah, like, that's gonna happen.
stupid
ape. And didn't you say that a bunch of, like, the Dindu farmers were trying to blame it on the white people, saying that they did some witchcraft?
The whites, they use witchcraft and cast spells on the land so that the blacks couldn't grow anything.
Can
you hear me?
Yeah. Yeah, no,
of course.
No, yeah. Alfredi, I can't even.
Okay. Going back, because I was trying to say something. Okay, the Iceland Revolution happened in 2008 to 2011. Okay, Tom, do you hear that?
Yeah. I'm looking at the Wikipedia article right now. It looks like it was primarily the financial crisis in Iceland that caused this revolution.
That was a lot of the world had a financial crisis at that time. Here in America, it was like all the houses.
Wait, was it like a left wing revolution, or is it like a libertarian?
Well, it looks like people were. One second. Yeah, because prior to 2009, Iceland was under control by a primarily right wing government, and many of the protesters were left wing. They wanted more financial reforms and more regulations on banking. And that's why the revolutions came about. But anyway, back to Rhodesia, because I think that's more interesting.
And on the Mugabe thing, though, too. I brought up that Allende did the same thing. He took land away, and they were just food shortages start happening.
Exactly. Yeah, that's what
and the food shortages in, like, Chile led to the rise of black markets. But as soon as Pinochet came to power and set the capitalist reforms, all the black markets went away.
Well, Venezuela's having food shortages right now, I think, too.
You know what would have made Pinochet even cooler?
What?
Like, I would be totally for it if he decided to go Austrian instead of just Chicago Boys.
What did they do? What did you say, like, America at Franco's funeral, he paid, like, homage or something like that?
Oh, you mean go full Jew instead of half Jew.
it's kind of funny, because, like, the reason that Rhodesian... The ethnic whites in Rhodesia lost the Rhodesian Bush War was because, not because, like, they lost due to poor military tactics. Like, the Rhodesian army was one of the best trained and best equipped in the world. It was because they were just completely outnumbered by the blacks. Like, if you read some of the accounts of the Rhodesians who fought against the like ZANU and ZAPU and all these fucking commie organizations, like, they wouldn't, like, ZANU, they wouldn't even, like, organize in battle. They basically, like, the leaders would just basically say, like, kill the white men, go and, like, kill them all, and they would just, like, unleash these people, and they would just, like, run in, like, guns blazing with AK-47s. They just, like, didn't take any cover or anything. But they thought that, like, they would be protected by magic spells from bullets. And they
well,
all
Tom, Like, Tom, that's like every African war.
Yeah, pretty much.
Like Liberia, they had General Butt Naked just come out full naked.
Yeah, but they only won by force of numbers.
Most of the game was with the Red Army, though, too.
Yeah, well, yeah. Is somebody being tortured in the background? I keep hearing screaming.
America. No,
child complaining in the background.
Okay, America.
Are they complaining about pedophile phobia?
Okay, everything.
America. Yes. Did you call Grover Fur yet?
You want me to call Grover? Oh, I can probably call Grover Fur right now. You guys want me to do it on the show?
You can if you like.
Oh, that'd be great. Let me mute myself and make sure everything's good.
We'll see if Alfred is in the same room.
By the way, Alfred, nice to meet you. I just met you.
He brought up the Jew point, which was pretty funny.
Yeah. As soon as I saw a picture of the unstumpable one, I was like, even I had to, like, bow. Even I, Pinochet, had to bow. But let me get my Grover Fur phone number thing.
Oh, all right.
Pinochet lives on today through Trump.
Hey, dude, you want to know what happened in school on accident to me?
What happened?
So me and my friends, we were doing that baking session, like where we'd like to burn each other as a joke. And you know what I told them, what slipped out of my mouth? I said, you deserve a helicopter ride, but nobody understood the joke.
Oh.
It just like slipped out.
And they're like, oh, what's that? Nothing.
Yeah, you know, like, I do have, like, one of the teachers in my school is a socialist, and it's like, she's really annoying. I'm actually probably going to say that, but I wonder if I'll get, like, in trouble. Like, if she'll realize what it is.
Are you still in high school?
You went in a helicopter ride.
Yeah. I'm a high school kid.
Everybody, like,
are you a junior or senior?
Oh, I'm junior. I'm actually going to be senior next year.
Oh.
Yeah. It has to do with my district. I got held back for, like, 1 year.
Oh, that sucks.
So, like, I'm a junior. I should be a senior this year, actually. And it has nothing to do with intelligence or anything like that. It's just, like, I got screwed.
Yeah, because I was in Puerto Rico, and since the school system is flawed, I'm, like, in a grade behind a little bit. Because not because I'm dumb. It's because the school district thing is weird.
Okay, I got Grover Fur's phone number here. I'm going to call him live on the air. You're going to hear.
Put it on speaker just so we can all hear it.
Okay. Oh, wow, Gustav Sol Invictus gave me his phone number. Can we call a Gustav Sol Invictus?
Yeah, let's have a conference call with Grover Fur and Augustus.
You know who Augustus is?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's great, Tom, because, like, I thought I was, like, the only person who discovered this, like, I disagree with his, he has pagan beliefs, I disagree with that, but I did like some of the stuff on his...
Come on, that's the best part about his ideology. You can just screw the libertarianism, but the paganism can stay.
Pagans and Christians will fight a lot.
Augustus Sol Invictus actually got banned from Canada. He tried to come up and give a speech here a couple months ago, and a bunch of the leftists in, I think, Montreal, they threw a fucking tantrum. And
Augustus gave me his phone number on Hangout, so I guess he wants me to call him.
Yeah.
Call Grover Fur first.
Call Grover Fur first. Where one feminist...
she got pissed for
it. I'm
calling Grover Fur right now, you guys.
Something,
wasn't it? Yeah, Lauren Southern, she got piss poured on her by a bunch of fucking triggery protests.
Triggery path!
Oh, okay, you're Grover Fur. Well, we're doing, I work, you know, I'm a conservative, so I kind of disagree with your views, but I'm interested in interviewing you, Wes Douglas.
I can't hear him.
Okay, I have a friend here. He's from Puerto Rico, and he's done a lot of research on Stalin, and he wants to talk to you. Yeah. Sure thing. What time is best for you? Oh, okay. I mean, I it would be pretty long because he has a lot of information like about Stalin he wants to talk to you about. So I really didn't want to do this person. Okay, wait, dude, can you call him back at 7 o'clock?
Today?
Oh. Okay, cool. God bless you. Wow, he accepted my God bless you. I'm amazed.
Wait, do you really call him? Because I couldn't hear him.
You couldn't hear him?
No, I keep telling you.
He said call him at 7 o'clock, which it's 6:25 p.m. here in Eastern Standard Time land.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't hear him talk.
I can't put it on. I don't know how to put it on speaker. You want me to try to get Augustus Sol Invictus on here?
Just send him a link to the if he sent you a thing on Hangouts.
Oh, he did, so let's...
I could probably do is probably call him on my phone. Not my, like in Google.
Hell, we've got Ethan... Center-Right Federation's got David Cerini on here before, so...
Yeah, didn't you say you were talking to Jack Donovan before?
Yeah.
Yeah, you should try to get him on.
Yeah, the whole conversation with Arini was pretty cool, though. I'll have to admit. Yes. All
right. Are you sure you really talked? Because I couldn't hear him. Oh, my God.
Didn't do nothing ridiculous.
Oh, my God. I'm going to debate with Red Scare TV's role model.
His boyfriend.
Oh, Gober.
His crush.
Metal Fox, buddy.
Call him back at 7. Does anyone know how I could get Grover Fur? Is not. Can we call? Is there a way we can call? Wait, I figured out a way.
All I have to say is we should get people like Grover Fur, take him up on a helicopter, put lead weights on his feet, take him over the Marianas Trench, and drop him over the edge.
No, that's reserved for some other people who won't be mentioned.
Oh, yeah.
Sure. Well, let me send America the link, because he left on accident.
Ah, shit.
Stop being a fug.
Oh, boy, I'm nervous.
I'm back. I had a technical difficulty. Is there a way we can call him in the group hangout so everyone can hear?
What if you put him on speakerphone and then just turn your volume up really loud?
Okay, well, I can do that. Let me look for his number again.
I recommend Tom try to do his little fixing tips.
Okay, someone fix the mic. I know that you can call him with Google Plus Hangout, so you could call him. Like, there's an app that you can download, which is Google Plus Hangout, but you can call them by phone, and they don't know your phone number. You could try that with your phone. Put it on speaker.
I can definitely do that. Tell me if you can hear this.
A little bit. Like, can you make it louder?
Can you hear that?
Oh, yeah, I did. I just heard that.
Okay, cool. Let me try to call him. It's not 7 yet. It's 6:27. So how long are we going to be doing this? Because then I could probably call him at 7.
Well, cool. If we end this sooner, you and Luis can go do it on his channel.
I already set up a live broadcast, so when this hour's over, I'm going to go to my broadcast, and I'm going to invite you.
Send me the link on Nation States, and then we can call Grover Fur there.
Oh.
what is your name?
None of the commies go away.
Pinochet, what is your nation on Nation States?
Huguenots. Yeah. It's like a French nation, like a French Protestant nation.
Oh, okay.
Hey,
yeah, I'm
Ecostan.
Yeah, the theocracy of Ecostan.
I don't see you making dispatches. You can put this fact book, and you can write an entire paragraph about your history of your nation.
We're talking about that because I think the GM was gonna say, Tom, that if you didn't, he was just it was gonna make your country like almost like the history of it would have been like one of my colonies because my country is Jewish as well.
Okay, yeah, I'll look into that.
Yeah, the history of my nation, we were French, you know, Calvinists. You know, we were Huguenots, and we fled to this land. There were some Dindus there. We kind of conquered the Dindus. So since then, we've had a problem because there's been the Dindus since, you know, modern times communism. Dindus get easily influenced. Okay, and we also have a problem with cultural Marxism. So we had a leader who's glorious. I actually used a picture of Pat Buchanan for him because Pat Buchanan's a hero.
Oh, that's funny. That's actually pretty funny for nation states.
Yeah, and he purges like
cucks.
Yeah, of the cucks and of the cultural
Marxism. That's funny. I have a similar problem, but it's not cultural Marx. Like, it's actual communists like trying to destabilize, to overthrow the government.
Can you make a second nation and put it in
Yeah, we can talk to this a little bit off the screen.
I have other nations like Lebanon, but that's a whole different story.
Yeah, we'll go into that like off the camera if you really want to join.
I really want to talk more to Tom, especially because like, Tom, you're a traditionalist.
Yeah, I have some very traditional beliefs.
I'm a radical traditionalist as well.
Yeah.
I also would consider myself kind of a traditionalist radical. In other words, I'm a radical traditionalist.
I'm not
for monarchy, because, like...
Louis.
Okay, I'm going to leave and do more research on Stalin. You can send me... I'm going to call you on Nation State, send you the link to the live broadcast, and then you can call him there.
Okay, that would be good.
And now the moderate right-wingers... not even right-wing, just the moderate libertarian leaves.
I don't even know if you could classify traditional beliefs as radical, though, because...
They're not, because really the non-traditional beliefs are radical because they came, you know, during the Jacobinism and all that, which really was, you know, radical and extremist. It came from the left. Its history is bloody. You ever hear of Kerry Bolton?
Yeah.
He wrote a book called, The Psychotic Left? And he shows you, like, the entire history of the left, even before communism was bad. Like, the left, you know, even like, you know where BDSM comes from? Comes from the left. It comes from Marquis de Sade, all that sexual freedom crap.
Yeah, well, yeah, the word sadism comes from Marquis de Sade, but there was another, I believe it was an Austrian writer, Massock.
Oh, Alfred, and he put something funny in the chat. It's got, like, Hitler, so it's like, oh, Alfred.
Yeah, he wrote a book called Venus and Furs, which was where the word masochism came from. But yeah, like, as you were saying, modern-day leftism or progressivism, it really started... with like these writers like Rousseau back in the mid 18th century who really inspired the French Revolution, and we're really feeling the reverberations of the French Revolution today with modern leftism.
Well, you know, I've read stuff on the French Revolution, Tom, and it seems like the cultural Marxism that we are experiencing today is like neo-Jacobinism.
Yeah, it's very similar. Like, because, especially with these like purity spirals, like what we saw with the Great Terror. With what was his name?
Robespierre,
yeah. Like anybody who was considered an enemy of the revolution, they would say, like, was guillotined. Like, even people like Danton or there's the other guy. His name escapes me right now. But a lot of these people who would have been considered revolutionaries in 1789 were executed and put to death because they were not considered radical enough. And that's really what we're seeing today. It's
exactly.
This giant purity spiral, because people like who would have been considered like radical left wing in the year 2000 are now being looked at as like, hey man, you're not advocating for like transsexual, pedophile, queer rights. Like you need to be shunned from the movement.
Exactly. And like even like, you know, classical liberals, you know, they would be radical back in the day, right? Like,
well, I mean, it depends where you're talking about. Like early 19th century Britain, they embraced classical liberalism.
Yeah, but I'm saying in France, liberalism was fucked up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much so.
Even like back then, like in 2005, like around the early 2000s, like all the Sargonites, they would have been embraced by most of the left, and then they'd see people like me, center right, and like America is the enemy.
Yeah, like pretty much all these like anti-SJWs who call themselves cultural libertarians on YouTube right now, like all those people would have been like fedora wearing leftist atheists back in 2005.
Oh, evil Christian bigots.
Yeah, they would have been calling all us bigots.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's just now like it's just gotten so bad that even they are under attack now.
Mm-hmm.
So we're stuck working with them, kind of thing.
Exactly. That's why, you know, like, I embrace Sargon of Akkad, even though I don't like him, because he's a liberal.
A degenerate.
Yeah.
He is a total degenerate. In fact, somebody was like surprised. Like, I had a buddy at school, and I'm like, you know, Sargon Akkai's like, well, I'm surprised you embrace him. Like, you know, he's an atheist, and I'm like, well, you know, I share a common enemy, and that's the SJWs.
It's gonna be like the U.S. and the Soviet Union. You're gonna have a common enemy, but once it's over, it's gonna be a cold war from there.
Oh yeah, you know, like, and even like a Lauren Southern. What exactly are her views?
I do not know.
I thought she was like.
She's kind of like in Sargon of Akkad's camp. Like, she's, I think she's pretty centrist politically, but she's against.
Let Alfred speak. Don't let Alfred.
Sure.
Alfred.
Well, Kudinov Kalergi in his book Practical Idealism classifies the current democracy as an intermedium between two dictatorships. You know, the first one being feudalism and the second one being something that isn't legal to mention in modern society because of a certain group, which he thinks is the leader class of the future. Mm-hmm. But
well, you're in Germany, so you probably can't say.
Needs an ideological basis.
I'm assuming it's communism.
Not even communism. I mean, communism not, but Marxism in a way. Cultural Marxism combined with a combination between a free market, relatively free market, and a semi-authoritarian state, so to say.
That's sort of like what America is kind of facing today, if you think about it.
So, and this is basically the push from what what Kudinov Kalergi called the aristocracy of blood, so the European ruling class, for example, towards a new ruling class of pen and paper, what he called it, pen and paper, so to say, of journalists, of bankers, of and so on.
Yeah, that actually is the way it is today. I mean, even in like I think Greece, like the bankers actually run the economy. I think.
Well, yeah, you see the beginning of
by controlling the money system and by debt.
Yeah, technocracy.
Usually. Yeah, like as you were saying, like I think that this like the seed like the seeds of what you're referring to really began in Renaissance Italy in the 14th, 15th century, where you have these ruling families who really established themselves through trade, and they really built a name for themselves. Just by earning tons of wealth, that's really where the seeds of, you know, this move away from the aristocracy of blood, as you were saying, where it was ruled by like these dynasties and these kings, to the rule now, which is primarily by, you know, bankers and merchants and other individuals.
Have any of you ever read Secrets of the Federal Reserve by Eustace Mullins?
I haven't read it, but I know what you're talking about.
I read it.
You read it?
Haven't.
Oh, okay. I really suggest, because the Federal Reserve, you know, have you ever wondered why, you know, it always seems like the left never really opposes usury. You'd think they would, but...
Oh, we're against capitalism. We're against the bourgeois. I mean, they're not against usury.
That's yeah, right. Exactly. But yet the right has always opposed usury.
Mainly National Socialists, because the Jews.
Yeah, yeah, but I'm saying, like, even, like, before, you know, like, people, like, that's always, like, the excuse, like oh, Hitler opposed usury, so if you're against usury, you're an anti-Semite. But, like, usury's always really been on the right.
Well, hey, wait, by usury, do you mean...
No, anti-usury activism has been on the right. Because the left has actually embraced usury if you look at their economics.
Okay, but the term usury is very loose. Like, are you referring to, like, the charging of interest on loans of any kind, or, like, unfairly exploiting people?
The charge of interest on loans.
Okay, but that's necessary for the functioning of an economy. You have to have charging of interest on loans.
Like, well, true. But what I'm saying is the left, through their, you know, the Keynesian economic system... has been charging these ridiculously high loans on people, yet that they don't see that as like exploitation, but like they see the free market as exploitation, so it's hypocritical.
Well, I think you could make a reverse argument though, because prior to the 2008 financial crisis, one of the things that led up to that was subprime mortgaging, which essentially meant that you had these unscrupulous bankers who were giving out loans, who were giving out mortgages to people at absurdly low interest rates.
Oh yeah, that's ridiculous too. But so
so you have these people who had no hope of ever paying off their mortgage. And when you raise interest rates by a little bit, like all these people were kicked out of their houses.
I agree with you. And you know what my solution to that is? Don't give these people money. Don't give these people money that they can't pay back. You know,
That's almost an impossible ideal to have, though, because there's always going to be people who will loan you money, regardless of how bad your credit rating is, regardless of how bad you manage your finances. Like, you have these, I don't know, I'm sure it's like the same in the United States, but here in Canada, we have a ton of these subprime mortgage lenders like Money Mart and like Western Union who just prey upon really stupid people and say like, hey, we'll give you a $300 loan for $20, and then we're not going to tell you about all the subtext, though, Goy, you know, and it ends up being like, you end up paying $400 interest.
That's why I would never accept a loan from anyone that I would have to pay back. You know, that's why I believe in, you know, the good old work ethic. You know, you need to work to get yourself out of a problem. You know, it's so stupid. These people expect they're going to get free money. You know, they think the welfare state's going to give them money. They think, you know, the bank is going to give them money. But they never work for money. This is, I think, the left has created, you know, this type of, you know, what should I call it, a welfare culture where it's just all these bums. And they don't want to contribute to society. They just want to make free money, and you know.
Or it's the give me that, give me that graffiti.
It's the give me that. You know? I do. But,
like, the thing is, like, I agree with what you're saying in a sense, but I just don't think that you're ever going to get rid of unscrupulous bankers who will just take advantage of people's stupidity.
Oh, that's always going to happen. I mean, you can't really prevent that. You know. I mean, the best thing you can do is just prevent it from happening at a federal level. Like, you know what I mean? From happening at the biggest, you know, the central bank.
But I mean, like, I get a lot of flack for this, but I'm actually not against central banking. I think it's, like, I'm against the gold standard as well. I don't think that...
Oh, I'm for the gold standard, because I think...
Like, here's the thing. Like, I've talked about this at length in previous podcasts, but the problem with the gold standard is that the extent to which your economy can grow is limited by the amount of gold in your reserves. So in order for your economy to expand, you have to keep mining new gold reserves. And basically, first of all, you're spending money on mining to look for new gold. And second of all, it really creates a system of mercantilism where people are going to hoard gold and they're going to abstain from trading with people, just so that they can maximize their gold and maximize their wealth. And thing, if you look at certain countries throughout history, such as Spain in the 15th century, where they tapped into these giant silver mines in South America, like, you see this massive inflation, which essentially crippled their economies, because when you inject a giant amount of precious metals into a nation's economy, then essentially it causes huge inflation, and people, like, it causes a huge financial crash. So, like, gold is just not... It's just not as stable as of a currency as a lot of people think it is.
You know,
I'll mute myself. Hold on.
Hitler didn't use gold. He used I think it was actually, you know, the blood and sweat, you know, of the German working man. Currency. I think it was something like that. I don't know. But I heard that Hitler actually figured out, like, a solution to banking. I haven't really researched that 100%, but I've heard it sounded pretty interesting.
Yeah, Hitler actually embraced Keynesianism.
Yeah, he did. I don't like Keynesianism because I think it leads, you know, it's part of the problem. But, you know, Hitler basically he ran a Keynesian economy, but at the same time he managed to get away from, like, the a lot of the, you know, from the global banks and all that existed at that time, you know, some of the wealthy bankers.
The thing about, like, Keynesianism is a really loose term because there have been like thousands of different interpretations of Keynes's work. But Keynes actually said, basically the way that a lot of governments practice economics in the current year is actually contrary to what Keynes was talking about, because Keynes believed that if you have a budget surplus, then you should spend money, like increase fiscal policy and fiscal spending in order to what he called prime the pump of the economy, which is which stimulated demand and increased employment. But a lot of governments, specifically like Canada and the United States, they have these massive, massive budget deficits, yet they still continue to increase fiscal spending in an attempt to stimulate aggregate demand, which doesn't work. And that's exactly what Keynes disagreed with. So, I mean, to call what you see today Keynesianism, it's really not at all. It's really a bastardization of Keynes's beliefs.
So it's not. It's more like a, what would you say it is?
It's I mean, it's definitely influenced by Keynes, but there's a lot of I don't know what I would call it.
There's a lot of other elements to it.
Yeah, there really isn't a term for what the current economic system. You have to understand, the current economic system in most Western countries is not influenced by any sort of ideology like monetarism or Keynesianism. It's just sort of like this. It's just like this central banking ad hoc economy where they're just trying to prevent the economy from completely collapsing. That's essentially what they're doing right now.
Oh yeah, well,
because right now you have what's called a liquidity trap, which essentially means that in the United States and most Western countries, as well as Japan, basically interest rates are as low as they can go. So you can't influence the economy through monetary policy, that is by printing new money, because interest rates will just, they won't go anywhere. So you have to use fiscal policy, and that's what they're doing right now, by taxing more and spending more. And that's what they're trying to do to increase aggregate demand.
Now here's another topic that offend a lot of people watching, but how do we defeat communism today?
I think that we need to initiate sort of like a neo-McCarthyism. I think that McCarthy, despite what many leftists say, McCarthy actually had it right, because in the late 1940s and early 1950s there were actually a ton.
Yeah, McCarthy was right. Get over it, McCarthy.
Yeah, McCarthy was absolutely right. There were a ton of communists in the entertainment industry, in Hollywood, and in the government. And to uproot and physically remove these people, you have to basically just call them out. And I think that's what we need to do right now, especially in the university, especially in Hollywood and entertainment.
Oh yeah, Hollywood is just full of like cultural Marxist propaganda.
Yeah, back in the 1960s. You have these huge name actresses like Jane Fonda. I don't know if you know who Jane Fonda is.
Yeah, I know. She actually went with the Viet Cong.
Yeah, she met with Ho Chi Minh, and she was hanging out with the Vietnamese army. That's crazy. Hollywood back in the 50s and 60s was super communist. And if we followed McCarthy's lead and we uprooted these people and called them out, then we probably wouldn't have faced the same problems that we do today. But lo and behold, we turn McCarthy into some sort of demon character and say, all these poor people, they were unfairly labeled and blacklisted.
The reason why I think they turned him into that, by the way, is because the people funding these communists are the wealthy bankers, the Ford Foundation, the Rockefeller Foundation, the big foundation, are behind.
Yeah, and don't forget the Soviet Union.
Even George Soros.
Yeah, George Soros especially. He's a more modern phenomenon.
Yeah, don't forget back then there was the Soviet Union.
Yeah, right? The Soviet Union back then, but I'm saying Russia probably doesn't fund these groups now. I would.
Yeah, now we have other groups there, Goy, who will subvert our ideas.
We have the only groups Russia's funding now is Donbass, and that's about it.
Yeah. Wait, Russia funds Hamas?
I said Donbass, like the Don, like the two runaway republics in Ukraine. Yeah, in Ukraine, yeah, they're funding them like nuts. Like they
Russia doesn't fund Hamas. You mean Donbass? Yeah, the Donbass.
Yeah, Donbass. Yeah, like over there.
That's
in
a very diverse group. That's not really communist or you know any other. That's a really Big Ten group that has all kinds of people in it.
Yeah, I know a lot of commies and like National Socialists support them.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Well, it's the same thing with the Baathists. Both like Third Positionists and communists will support them.
Yeah, it's weird. But, like, you know, I think you ever, in fact, this is, Del, I don't know, have you ever read Hans Hermann Hoppe, Democracy, the God That Died?
No.
Anyone ever read that? Tom?
Anyone?
Nah.
I think Tom would have read it. Okay. Have you ever read it? Democracy, the God That Died? Nobody read that?
That's, they say God's dead. The only God that's dead is democracy. That's what I'm saying. The only God that's dead is democracy.
Exactly. Democracy is like a false idol that everyone, like, you know, looks up to. Oh, democracy. And, like, you know, that's why these communists were kind of able to run loose because, like, everyone, like, embraced the demon crazy. And that's kind of what I'm calling democracy here. So they just assume that these communists, you know, they just let them run loose and do their damage. You know. You remember there used to be the House Un-American Activities
Committee? Oh, yeah, I think some communists were joking how I was going to report them to that.
Yeah, HUAC. That's like, they need to bring back HUAC.
At this point, you would think we do, because there's too many communists running around now.
They need to investigate, like, George Soros, they need to investigate the Southern Poverty Law, all these groups. You know, and also, like, even, like, groups like, I even think that communists are behind, like, the Klan and all. Like, because the modern Klan is just, like...
retarded.
They should also investigate the ADL.
Yeah, the ADL, too.
Well, you have to understand that the Klan... you're right, America. The Klan is probably funded in large part by left-wing communist groups, because the Klan, you have to understand, serves a very important purpose for these people, because it serves as a boogeyman. They have to point to the Klan and say, look at these evil people, they're out to get us. But you have to understand, like, the Klan doesn't really exist. The members of the Klan who are genuine about it, they're just a bunch of disparate groups, like hillbillies out in the woods. They don't really have any real influence.
Yeah, exactly. They're like...
They're propped up as though they're some sort of, like, evil entity.
There's not that many of them, even, like...
Yeah, so,
like,
maybe a couple thousand.
Government informants is another thing. And Southern Poverty Law Center informants. It's all fake. And I'm going to tell you another thing. Like, we need to bring back, like, HUAC. Because, you know, especially with, like, on the campuses, you know, the stuff that's happening on the campuses is just completely demonic. You know, like, for example, Grover Furr. We just call him right on the show. Grover Furr. That guy's openly telling kids, generations of American youth, that Stalin never killed anyone. So, does that mean it's okay to say Hitler never killed anyone?
That's racist. I'm calling my lawyer, you bastard.
And plus, you want to know the ironic thing? Stalin himself was an anti-Semite who had contributions to the Holocaust.
Well, so did the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem. But that whole thing with Husseini being part of contributing to the Holocaust, that hurts the Palestinian narrative. They can't advance it if that's true.
Yep.
It makes them look bad. It makes their entire movement look bad. They'll say, oh, the Zionists are the Nazis of the Middle East, and yet if you say Husseini played a role in the Holocaust, that hurts them.
Yeah,
they're unable to advance it.
Commies hide their anti-Semitism. They hide behind the anti-Zionist banner.
They do.
Also, I figured out why Tumblr is so retarded. Tumblr is a blog where you can basically just block out any disagreeing opinions. So that's why leftists are able to gather there and, like...
Yeah, I think Tumblr should be investigated as well.
Yeah. And also, even Facebook, like, there's a whole scandal with Facebook now. Like...
Well, the issue with Facebook is a lot different than with Tumblr, because you have, like, Zuckerberg and the JIDF.
Zuckerberg!
They're actively censoring Facebook posts. It's not like in Tumblr where it's just people blocking each other. It's if you, like, there are stories, like, I read a story of a guy in Scotland who he called somebody a nigger on Facebook, and he basically was arrested. He was charged with hate speech, and, like, the guy's life is ruined. Like, he won't be able to get a job anywhere.
That's so stupid. Why would they arrest somebody? I mean, not for that word, but, like, why arrest somebody for saying that word? It's so stupid.
Arrest it's a word.
Because it hurts people's feelings, there, Goy.
Yeah. Yeah, so I hear commies, they go, oh, you're not for free speech either, but the difference is we're not censoring people over a word.
Yeah.
These people are.
The thing is with commies, like, I think it's like they really do want, like, kind of an Orwellian society. Just look at how these the social justice warriors are. Because, I mean, if you really think about it, they want to, like, even, like, try to, like, destroy beauty now. Like,
they're going after everything.
Yeah, it's like, it's just total, like, just demolition of society. It's total degeneracy.
Well, one of my favorite, like, lectures was by a guy named Yuri Bezmenov. Have you seen these?
Oh, yeah, he's a communist spy or something, right?
Yeah. I've talked about him lots of times on the alt-right
Hangout videos.
Yeah, he talks about demoralization, where you have to, you have to break down a society's sense of greatness and of itself, and then these people will just lose the willingness to fight and fight against subversion and degeneracy. And basically you're seeing that right now with not only with, like, postmodern art, but also with, like, music. Like, when's the last time you heard a song on the radio that actively glorified nationalism or God or, like, the United States?
No,
it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
It's all just a bunch of, like, high time preference degeneracy, and whether it's a concerted effort or not, that actively serves to demoralize the population.
Well, you know, John, even Sun Tzu and, like, you know, the ancient ninjas and stuff. The way I said that, ancient ninjas and stuff. Martial arts, you know, philosophers all talked about subversion and subverting the gods and the land and the people's beliefs and stuff like that.
Yeah, the best way to win is to prevent your enemy from fighting in the first place.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
what I actually had that. Right, if I could, I probably can't find it right now, but Sun Tzu actually wrote in one of his books,
The Art of War.
Yeah, I think he even mentions, like, going into lands and, like, subverting their religion and things.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know if he talks directly about religion, but he mentions several times that you have to use the enemy's force against them. You have to turn the elements within the enemy's ranks and their society against them so that it makes them demoralized and unwilling to fight you.
Yeah. I have a bookmark because I actually saved a lot of this stuff on ninjutsu and stuff. Let me look for it.
That's the primary idea behind the practice of jujitsu. Is where you turn the enemy's force against them.
Yeah, you use their own power against them. And that's what we're seeing in the form of cultural Marxism, because these people are actually in academia.
Exactly.
We're not talking about, like, guerrillas running around with machine guns shooting people. We're talking about people in power.
Yeah, even while the Soviet Union existed, I mean, the effort that they devoted to, like, actively, like, going and blowing up bridges and assassinating people, like, that was a very, very small part of what the KGB did. Most of what they did was trying to subvert the ideals of Western society.
Exactly. Well, you know, cultural Marxism began with, I think it was, who's the Hungarian dude? I forgot his name.
George Lukács.
Oh, yeah, you brought him up.
Well, I mean, there was, prior to that, there was Antonio Gramsci, who was an Italian, who was widely considered to be the forefather of cultural Marxism, with his book, The Prison Notebooks, where he basically says that the way to implement communism was to basically tear down the hegemony of the ruling elites. Because, like, he believed that the reason why the working class had not revolted against capitalism and overthrown the system was because they were somehow brainwashed. They had internalized the values of capitalism and the elites, and that they had lost the willingness to fight. And he said, like, if you tear down, like, these institutions, like the family, like religion, like the nation state, and then the people will just become disillusioned and they'll be more malleable and more willing to be mobilized for the communist revolution. And a lot of these people who came after him, like Lukács, like the Frankfurt School, like the second wave feminists and the New Left, they embraced these ideas. And they basically called for a long march through the institutions where they would just slowly brainwash people over several generations in order to make communism more palatable.
A gay activist who admitted that the whole gay marriage thing, you know, to basically get rid of marriage. Let me read that.
Yeah, I know.
It's in the Gay Liberation Manifesto. He said that the best way to abolish the family is to redefine it and allow gays to have families.
Exactly. I'm going to read this to you here. A 2012 speech by Masha Gessen. I don't know if that's a man or I guess it's a woman. It's a lesbian. An author and outspoken activist for the LGBT community is just now going viral and includes a theory that many supporters of traditional marriage have speculated about for years. The push for gay marriage has less to do with the right to marry. It is about diminishing and eventually destroying the institution of marriage and redefining the traditional family. Gessen shared her views on the subject and very specifically stated, gay marriage is a lie. Fighting for gay marriage generally involves lying about what we're going to do with marriage when we get there. It's a no-brainer that the institution of marriage should not exist. This is what these people believe.
And most of these, these Sargonites, they will go, oh, that's just a right-wing Christian conspiracy theory, and they'll ignore it.
Yeah, but that's, you know, this is what the gay activists themselves are saying.
We knew this was coming. Even like with the normalization of pedophilia and all this stuff, we know it's coming. But eventually, all these Sargonites are gonna be like, "This is happening." I'm gonna be like, "We're gonna go." We knew this was gonna happen, you freaking idiots.
Oh yeah, and like it's funny because like I can't believe that the SJWs are legalizing pedophilia. I've seen this coming for years. I mean, I haven't really been alive for years, but I remember reading about this stuff before it actually, you know. I was alt-right before it was cool, folks.
Oh, I was alt-right before it was cool.
Okay, you know, back when I was 11, I kind of realized some of this stuff. So.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, the push for normalizing pedophilia, as I mentioned before, it's not new. You have these guys in the early 90s, like Allen Ginsberg, who was one of the prominent members of NAMBLA, who was a huge commie, and he was pushing very hard for pedophilia. Yeah, and actually, during the late 90s... Liberation I would argue that during the late 90s, they actually had a lot more success with pushing that because the acceptance of pedophilia was actually a lot more accepted back in the late 90s than it is today.
Well, Tom, the only way that we can defeat this, and this is going to sound pretty radical to the people listening, is we need to get rid of gay marriage in the American Constitution. We actually need to ban it in our Constitution.
I think Tom made himself, because that was good.
Yeah, we need to ban gay marriage. We actually need a law in our Constitution that says, you know, marriage is between one man and one woman. That's my view on that.
Oh, yeah, that's like, that's what I said. The Ukrainians, the Polish, and the Belarusians have done it already.
Yeah, exactly. Delta, that is my idea. Just like what the Slavs have, we need to do in the United States. Also, another thing, we need to ban, like what Russia did, ban gay propaganda.
Well, I think Kyrgyzstan is doing that now.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
A lot of Central Asian countries, I think, are starting to follow Russia.
Actually, I would have to slightly disagree with you about banning gay marriage in the Constitution, because if you really think about it, why would two gay people ever want to get married in the first place? Like, it doesn't even make sense for them to get married.
It doesn't.
Unless they're like LARPy and they want to play like middle class American family. like most gay people, they're not monogamous. They fuck everything. So it doesn't make sense for them to have a traditional relationship.
Yes, you're right.
So I think what we need to do instead of just outright banning it is just to not present it as a valid alternative to heterosexual marriage. Because if more people were told that no, gay marriage, that's not a thing. That's fucking stupid. And instead we're told, you should find a good wife and marry her and have kids with her.
Okay, he's already 7. Like, I'm going to take the live broadcast. Who else wants to join?
You could have done it right here, Luis.
I could do it right here if you guys want me to.
Sure.
Okay. Oh, man, it's going to be hard to... Now, Lewis, it's going to be hard for you to talk to this guy over a phone that I'm using. Like, I'm actually using a phone.
I'm not actually not sure how long I can stay, but I'll try to stay for as long as I can.
Okay. Tom, I'm going to ask you, what do you think of, like, my idea of banning gay propaganda? Like, banning, you know, the gay parades and all that. Like, is that public indecency?
That happened in Moscow. They did it in Moscow, and then...
Yeah, most of the stuff that the LGBT does during the pride parades could be pretty degenerate.
Yeah, so of course, I'm, like, out with it.
Like, could, like, you know, have a negative effect on the minds of children.
Oh, it has no effect on society, key individuals.
The thing is, like, I'm a free speech advocate. I think that if you want to advocate for, you know, gay rights or whatever, that's fine, go ahead. But I think that the government should have to step in at some point and say, no, this is wrong. This is not going to lead to a healthy society, and we're not going to fund you. We're not going to encourage you at all.
Well, yeah, well, you know, I'm all for free speech too, Tom, but, like, I'm talking about these people having these parades, like, you've seen Pussy Riot, or, like...
Oh man, dude, come to Canada. Come to Canada. Whatever you have in the United States is nothing compared to.
I know, it's much worse. I saw the Lauren Southern, the slut walk video.
Yeah,
or it's even worse in Europe. I think in Europe.
Yeah, I think that Toronto has one of the biggest gay pride parades of all time, and not only that, but our new prime minister Justin Trudeau actually participates in these things.
He goes
around and takes pictures of these people.
You gotta be joking! He's actually going to the parade.
Yeah, no, there are tons of pictures of him taking pictures with these faggots. It's disgusting.
And there's, like, kids twerking, and it's like, what?
With the village people, like, taking, like, a picture with, like, some village people do, like, with assless chaps.
Yeah, like, that happens all the time.
All right. I'm going to invite two people. It's going to be America and who else? I need one person because I want to do it in a separate chat.
Oh, okay. Do you want to end the Hangout right? Do you want to end the stream right now?
Well, Delta, I want to talk to you later.
Actually, I think that if we're going to talk to Grover Fur, we should probably do it in a separate stream because this has gone on for, like, what, 2 hours now?
So
if somebody's going to watch it, they probably want to see Grover Fur, like, immediately. So, let's end the stream and do a separate one.
Yeah, all right, folks. So we're going to end it here. We're going to do a... Let's say, Tom, mute yourself. Otherwise, I'm echoing.
Free helicopter rides for leftists.
So wait, you still want me to make one?
Luis, I'm trying to...
Am I echoing?
Yeah, you're causing a huge echo. All
right, yeah, I'll log out and log back in.
Okay, before I end the stream. Okay, so we're going to end it here. Tom's going to come back real quick, but... I know Ethan or just Center Right Federation said free helicopter rides. That's great. Luis, anything?
Well, I can't wait to debunk Grover Fur because I have some questions for him.
Oh, about the Holodomor.
Not just that. I want to have like mostly on the Dayton massacre because I read an article he posted.
Oh man, I saw you argue with like Red Scare TV and like a bunch of commies in one huge hangout.
Center.
Yeah.
We're going to call some Grover Fur, man.
All right, go ahead.
Wait, not yet. Is it? We have to put me in a separate life.
Yeah, I'm waiting for Tom to log back in before I cut it. So.
I think Tom had to go, did he?
Oh, yeah. No? He said he was going to log back in. Oh, he's back.
Oh, cool. Okay. Tom.
Yeah, any last words?
Am I echoing?
Not much anymore. You have any last words?
No, not really.
Okay, I'll say some stuff. Okay, I sound really stupid when I just said I'll say some stuff, but... Okay, ban gay propaganda. That's all I gotta say. Okay, I mean, they can... I don't know. They shouldn't be promoting that crap in society. You know, I don't want the United States to become like Canada. Sorry, Tom.
Oh, I don't want it becoming like Europe.
Oh, that's even worse. Actually, no. Canada compared to Europe, which is worse?
Well, I mean... I'm sure that what you're referring to when you refer to Canada is really Toronto, because most parts of Canada are not like that at all.
Oh, okay.
Who's Canada has somewhat
decent. Oh, wait, no, you are right. You're right, Tom, because when I was in Toronto, there was all these, like, trendy-dressed people. It was weird.
Yeah, Toronto is a complete shithole, but the rest of Canada is very nice. You should come here sometime.
Yeah. Okay, can we take a nap? I want to talk
to Toronto. Oh, yeah. Yeah, so we're going to end it here. This has been Del2SA, America... I'm just gonna say America because I don't know.
Confederate Federation.
Luis Murrow and
Vladivostok 3701.
And we're out. See you people later. Bye.